Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Ancient word ever true, change us tonight.
Yes, Lord.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Let there be a transformation in and let it reflect outside of us.
Yes,
that your name alone be glorified. Lead us, Holy Spirit. Let there be a true dividing of the word and let the word prevail. In Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Let's be seated in the presence of the Lord this evening. Welcome to Disciples Convocation, where God has brought us together to share of His wisdom and His power. As disciples of Christ, Jesus said, "Consider us. As I am, so are you in this world." And the Bible says that Jesus is the wisdom and the power of God. So every time we come together as His disciples, we share in that wisdom and that power. And I pray that it will be experiential for us today in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Today we'll be observing by the leadership of the Holy Spirit what is captured: marriage, the foundation of ministry expression. Marriage, the foundation of ministry expression. What the Holy Spirit will be doing with us tonight is to help us see the interconnectivity and how marriage and ministry are interwoven, and how they produce similar results. How that you can't separate marriage from ministry, and you can't separate ministry from marriage. That's how God had ordained it from the beginning. And we're going to start by looking at an account in John chapter 2. That's where we start our observation from, and it's going to be our reference text. John chapter 2, and I'm going to read from verse 1 to verse 11. John chapter 2, verse 1 to verse 11. We are familiar with this, but I'm going to lay emphasis as I read on some particular portions of the scripture, and I would love you to carry on, you know, with the spirit of the scripture, so that we'll be able to get all that the Holy Spirit has for us within the limited time. John chapter 2, verse 1 to 11. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. And when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." Verse 4, Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servant, "Whatever he says to you, do it." Verse 6, now there were set there 6 water pots of stone, according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. Jesus said to them, "Fill the water pots with water." And they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, "Draw some out now and take it to the master of the feast." And they took it. When the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom, and he said to him, "Every man at the beginning sets out the good wine, and when the guests were well drunk, then the inferior. You have kept the good wine until now." Verse 11, "This beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him." May the Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now in verse 11, the Bible makes us understand that this was the beginning of signs that Jesus will show in ministry. He happened at a wedding. Now, when we talk about ministry and we talk about marriage, what is the connection? I would like to explain some things then it will serve as a background as we carry on in our conversation tonight. Ministry appears to be a public expression. When you are in ministry or when you are engaged in ministry, it's a public expression. A public expression of your role, of a part that God has called you to play in His grand agenda and plan. That's ministry. Ministry usually is not private, it's public. It has to do with people. That's why it's public. So when you have, we're talking about ministry here, know that we're talking about a public expression. A public expression of a person, a man or a woman. And that expression in the context of ministry we're talking about here, it's in relation to your role or your assignment in the grand agenda of God on the earth. Now, when we talk about marriage, and which we're going to see in several scriptures we're going to look at tonight, marriage is private. God instituted marriage, and I want us to see Genesis, where God actually instituted marriage. In Genesis chapter 2, what happened? Why did God introduce marriage? And in verse 18, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him. So this was the idea. This was the agenda. There was, out of everything God created, there was no helper for man. So God said, I will make him a helper comparable to him. And I want to fast forward and move down to verse 22. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken out of man. Therefore, a man, for this reason, marriage was now instituted. In verse 24, the Bible says, therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. When this happens, there is marriage. So a man will leave his father and mother and will cleave to his wife, and they will become one flesh. And in verse 25, he said, and they were both naked, the man and his wife, and were not ashamed. Marriage is private. Ministry is public, but marriage is private. Marriage is between two parties. When you look at the, is it vertical, they call it now, relationship. A man and his wife, no other person was mentioned here. For this reason, for the sake of marriage, marriage is instituted when a man and a man leaves his father and his mother and cleaves to his wife, and the two becomes one flesh. So it is private, but ministry is public. Then we want to now look at what is the interconnectivity between this private experience and this public expression. Why is this private experience important in this public expression? That is what the Holy Spirit will be helping us to see tonight. Now, when we read in John chapter 2, there was something that was really fascinating that was mentioned in verse 6. It said, now there were set there at that wedding, at the event of the wedding, 6 water pots of stone. For the first time, there is a link between religion, as it were, or ministry, and the wedding. It said, and there was set there 6 water pots of stone according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. This detail would not have been given if he was not wearing that. At the place where marriage was to be instituted or consummated, as it were, there was a link between that and ministry. He mentioned 6 spots specifically. And tonight we want to look at 6 expressions of ministry that is strongly linked with marriage. We want to look at what the 6 water pots, how they link, how there's an interconnectivity between this private experience called marriage and the public expression of ministry. But I want to start by looking at Proverbs chapter 18, which will be our first point. Proverbs chapter 18, verse 22. The Bible says, "He who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord." He who finds a wife finds a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord. In ministry, in Ephesians chapter 5, if you read from verse 15 downwards, when Apostle Paul was talking about the fact that they're talking about marriage and the mystery therein, he talked about marriage, then he talked about Christ and the church. And you see that everything he was referring to there in the marriage relationship, it was like a shadow of the real experience between Christ and the church. One thing I discovered is that a man can never give what he does not have. And that's the foundation of these 6 expressions. A man cannot express a favor he has not experienced. So for a man to express favor in ministry, he must have experienced it in marriage. And the Bible says here that that man that finds a wife finds a good thing and he obtains favor from the Lord. So favor is an experience, a private experience in his marriage that he brings into public expression in ministry. Ministry, God established ministry as an expression of his favor. When God chooses to favor a people, he sends a man, he sends a woman who plays a role or a part in his grand agenda. And the same way in marriage, there lies favor. The experience of favor leads to an expression of favor in ministry. So if you are in marriage and you are not experiencing favor, you cannot express favor. Because ministry is an expression of God's favor to his people. They did not deserve it, but God chose to show them his favor. But if you have not obtained favor from the Lord in marriage, you cannot express it in ministry. No wonder many ministers are struggling. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 7, I want us to go there. Apostle Peter was talking about something fundamental there when he was talking to husbands and wives. And in verse 7, he mentioned here that husbands likewise dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and being here together of the grace of God, that your prayers may not be hindered. So if you don't have a private experience of favor, you can't have a public expression of it. That means there's no ministry. Hallelujah. The second expression we'll be looking at, that is a strong link between thing between ministry and marriage is goodness. That God said in Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. And the Lord God said, it is not good. I want us to track back a little bit. From Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, when God started creating all that He created, He said, He created the light and the darkness. And He looked at it and He said, it was good. He created so many things and He looked at what He created and He said it was good. Until this point, God had not found fault. And at verse 18, the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. God found fault. And He said, I will correct it. I will make him a helper comparable. So marriage is a private experience of goodness. God brings goodness. God brought Eve as goodness into the life of Adam. The same way God brings your wife into your life as goodness. So if you don't have the private experience of goodness, you can't have a public expression of goodness. Because ministry is an extension of God's goodness. You can't say you are in ministry and you are not expressing God's goodness. And it is founded on your marriage relationship. If you have not received that goodness from God, you cannot express it. If you have not experienced the goodness of God, you cannot express it. Number three, also from the same scripture, Genesis chapter 2, verse 18, God said in verse, I want to read the big part of it. I will make him a helper comparable to him. Ministry serves as a platform for help. And I want us to also examine Ecclesiastes chapter 4. And I'll read verse 9 to 12. Such a powerful scripture. Ecclesiastes chapter 4, verse 9 to 12. Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their labor. For if they fall, one will lift up his companion. But woe to him who is alone when he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Again, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one be warm alone? Though one may be overpowered by another, two can withstand him. And a threefold cord is not quickly broken. See what he said in that verse 11. Verse 10b. He said, for he has no one to help him. So God created marriage as a private experience of help. In marriage is supposed to express help. That's one of the fundamental reasons why God created marriage. The marriage union is supposed to produce an informidable force. And he said, and ministry serves as a platform for help. When God wants to send help to a people, does it come down himself? He sends a minister. When the children of Israel were wallowing in Egypt, in their slavery situation, God heard their cry. What did God do? He sent the ministry of Moses to help them out of their situation. Until Moses came, until Moses was sent, they remained in their situation. So when Moses came, there was a shift, there was a provision of help. So the same way in marriage, when a woman comes into the life of a man, that woman comes as a help. And the man's situation will remain the same until the woman comes to help and shift and change the situation. Praise the Lord. So if a man has not experienced help in marriage, he cannot express help in ministry. Number four, how ministry and marriage are strongly linked and connected. Just like ministry is an answer and a solution, marriage is an answer and a solution. Ecclesiastes chapter 9, verse 9. Live joyfully with the wife whom you love all the days of your vain life, which he has given you under the sun. All your days of vanity, for that is your portion in life, and in the labor which you perform under the sun. One thing I want us to take from there, he said, he has given you, for that is your portion. That is your solution. That is your answer. And I want us to also notice that in Ecclesiastes chapter 4 that we read from verse 9, it said two are better than one because they have a good reward. They have a good solution to offer. They have a good reward for their labor. For if one fall, one will lift up his companion. So marriage is a solution. And I want us to also see Psalm chapter 127. I love that scripture. It talks about the fruit of marriage, the evidence of it, and what it does. Psalm chapter 127. I'll read from verse 3 to 5. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth, which are products of fruits of marriage. Happy is the man who has his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but shall speak with their enemies in the gates. They will have an answer for their enemy because of the experience, the private experience of marriage. The private experience of marriage leads to the public expression of ministry. So if a man or a woman gets it wrong in marriage, you cannot give what you don't have. You can't. You have to have obtained it to be able to give it. You must have, you would have received it before you can give it. So marriage is a solution and is an answer, just like ministries. God used ministries to answer questions. God used ministries to solve problems. The same way your marriage has been ordained by God to give answers and to give solutions. So if you are in a marriage that is not giving any answer, is not offering any solution, then you should check that marriage well and ask the Lord to help you. Because God has ordained marriage to be an answer. He has ordained it to be a solution. There is a problem your marriage is called to solve, just like your ministry is called to solve a problem. There's an answer that your marriage must deliver, just like your ministry must deliver an answer. There's something important that you are called to answer in your generation. So marriage is not for form, it's for function. Your private experiences must culminate unnecessarily into public expressions. I remember the story of Aquila and Priscilla in the scriptures. Such a powerful couple. They've been studying the word together in their closets. They've been enjoying the Holy Spirit until they understood that their private experience was not just for them. They encountered Apollos, and their private experience translated into a public expression. They were able to call the brother aside, teach him from their private experience. And that brother was on fire, expressing publicly what that marriage produced in him. What answer is your marriage producing? What is the solution your marriage is offering? Very important in the heart of God. So you must take it to heart. So when we look at people that have marital problems in ministry today, we want to check it. The Bible says if the foundation be destroyed, what can the righteous do? That ministry is but at the verge of shipwreck. Because the foundation that is carrying that ministry, which is the marriage of that man or one that has been affected, it's just a ticking time bomb. It will affect the whole ministry. Because there's no longer any experience that will carry the expression. And I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. So that we give attention to what is important. Many people are so consumed by the expression that they forget that it's experiences that bear the expression. When you leave your wife at home, care less about her spiritual development and growth, and you are busy going all around, you will come back. After you have finished burning out that expression, you will come back because you have to feed that expression with that experience.
Yes.
And if there's no experience, there won't be expression. It's not a matter of time. Time is a revealer of truth. You can be burning based on the experience that you've gotten so far. But it's a matter of time before the expression will fade because there's no experience to back it up. And I pray the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Because of time, number five, ministry is a war strategy of God. Just like marriage is the war strategy of God. You know that place we read in Ecclesiastes, chapter 4, it said, for if they fall, one will lift up his companion, but woe to him who is alone. When he falls, for he has no one to help him up. Marriage is a warfare strategy of God, just like ministry is a warfare strategy. Your marriage is fighting a battle, and you must be conscious of it. There's something that God has called that marriage to fight. And you, because the reason why you are fighting is because God has called that marriage to deliver something. And because what God has called that marriage to deliver is anti the devil, it's against his plans and schemes, it will fight you. So marriage is a warfare strategy of God. Just like ministry is a warfare strategy of God. So you are in your mind, don't be ignorant, you are fighting a battle.
Yes.
You are fighting, except your marriage is not in the plan and the will of God. If you are a minister and you are married, you are fighting a battle in your marriage, and you must not be ignorant of it. If you don't win in your marriage, you cannot win in ministry.
Yes.
If you are not celebrating victories in your marriage, you cannot celebrate it in ministry. Because your private experiences are what will feed your public expression. So you and your wife must be prayer partners. Because you are joined together in this private battle. You can have people that are praying in the church, praying in the ministry, but you and your wife must have dedicated time of praying together because you are fighting a battle. And that battle must be won. God uses ministries and marriages to confront and fight specific battles. Specific. What my marriage is fighting is different from what yours is fighting, because our assignment is different. And what God has instituted our marriage for is different. The purpose is different. You must be conscious of it. So my marriage is God's warfare strategy. So just like in ministries, you're taking over territories, in your marriage, you're taking over territories. Just like in marriage, you must be fruitful. In ministry, you must be fruitful. You must multiply in marriage. You must multiply in ministry. You must subdue and have dominion in marriage. You must subdue and have dominion in ministry. Because your private experiences will feed your public expression. Number six, which will be our final point. Marriage and ministry are intertwined in the level of fellowship. Ministry serves as a means of fellowship of like minds. Apostle Paul often admonishes, do not forsake the gathering of brethren. Brethren talks about brothers and sisters of like minds. So ministry brings together men and women of like minds. Just the same way in marriage. Adam said concerning Eve, this is now the bone of my bone and the flesh of my flesh. We share the same identity. We share the same likeness. We share the same nature. So marriage is about fellowship of like minds. You and your wife must have the same mind. Just like in a ministry, it is necessary. That was why God was angry with Aaron and Miriam. He said, this is the ministry I've called you to. Why are you busy speaking against my servant and friend Moses? Why are you not of the same mind with him? And God called them out and he punished them. Because in ministry, you must have the same, it must be a fellowship of like mind. For there to be results, for there to be progress, it must be a fellowship of like mind. So for any marriage to make progress, you must fellowship with your wife. You must fellowship with your husband in the same mind. You must share fellowship, communion together. That's the way you make progress. That's the way you advance the cause of God. That's the way you are able to, because the Bible says that a house divided against itself, it cannot stand. So there must be fellowship. In your marriage, there must be fellowship. There must be union. In ministry, there must be union. In ministry, you can't express the grand agenda of God in division. That's why the Bible is always calling us to the unity of faith. Unity of purpose. Bringing us all together under the umbrella of our head, Jesus Christ. So you can't be running alone on your own. That's not ministry. And we run our world if you are not careful, if you have run our world in your marriage. Because there's no fellowship in your home, because there's no union, proper union in your home, you will carry that deep with divisive spirit into ministry. That's why we have to be careful. There's such a strong bond and relationship between marriage and ministry. These are the six expressions that the Holy Spirit have released to us tonight. It's important for us to understand that this is the foundation. You can't excuse marriage in reform. There's some brothers that say, you know what? The way everything is going about me, I don't want to get married. Marriage is like a necessary evil. I don't want to be involved in it. But marriage is a gift of God to you. God gifts you with marriage so that your private experiences can lead to public expressions. If you don't have it, you can't give it. So if God has been pressing and leading you in the area of marriage, understand that there's something God wants you to experience so that you will be able to express it. And I pray the Lord will help you in the name of Jesus. I want us to bow our heads and just celebrate the Lord for this word he has sent to us. Just give him praise. Just say, Lord, I'm grateful. Thank you for opening my eyes. Thank you for the revelation of your word tonight. Let's just celebrate the Lord, give him praise for this word. I'm praying the direction the Holy Spirit is leading you. What area you need to improve upon, just pray.
Lord, we bless you for this world. We thank you for the entrance of your word that gives light and understanding to the simple. We thank you for revelation. We thank you for grace. We thank you for the vessel of utterance. We thank you for the change that you desire in our lives, in our ministries. Thank you for the change that you desire in our marriages. Thank you for teaching us the foundation for that change in our marriage. Father, we bless you. In Jesus' mighty name, we are giving praise.
Amen.
You do not receive it, you cannot give it. And ministry is about giving. Ministry is about giving spiritually, giving emotionally, giving physically. And your marriage is the place, the platform for receiving. There is no distributor who does not receive from the manufacturer. The distributor could connect with consumers directly or with smaller retailers. However, a distributor is as relevant to the degree of his connection to the manufacturer. It must be supplied if he can supply others. We must first be comforted before we can comfort others. You cannot export what you have not produced. If you lack hope in your marriage, you cannot become a source of hope in ministry. If the favor of God has not come upon you in your marriage, you cannot pray favor upon people. If you are struggling in your marriage, it is difficult to help people to be victorious in ministry. So God has also created the marriage as the place to learn, as the place to receive. But one of the things that a man and a woman should be careful in marriage is not to, while you give in ministry, you are the only one giving in marriage. That would be double draining. And for men, this is very important. Don't think because you are the head of that woman, she's foolish. There's nothing you can learn from her. It is not only about her cooking food for you. She can also cook food for you in the spirit. She can cook food for you in your soul. Don't tie a relevance to food, rice, spaghetti. Because a man who is not too deep in the things of God, who wants to be the only one taking the morning devotions, your wife cannot preach anything, your wife cannot catch a revelation. She should keep quiet while you speak. You are the same one, our daddy in the Lord, that is speaking in the church. You are the only one speaking in the morning devotion. You are just speaking everywhere. Every time there is an opportunity for a meditation of the word, you will begin it and only you will conclude it. So the same thing you knew, that's the same thing you know. Now, as you were releasing out, you are now releasing in. And so you'll be drained. God has given us a wisdom for life, a wisdom for ministry. If you will not be frustrated, if you will not be burnt out of ministry, then you must not be a man or a woman who perpetually gives out and then perpetually gives in. Learn to receive in. Learn to receive help. Now, why the man is expected to be helped by the woman? A wise man must learn to help his wife. That's one thing that we must never forget. The help is not one-sided. She will primarily help you whatever to help you. Everything we are doing on this earth is to, when we say, God said, I've called the man who executes my counsel from the far country, in Isaiah chapter, I think 46 or 45. And he says, my purpose will stand. But the emphasis is on the man who executes my will. God has the will, a desire to be done on the earth. Now there is a man that he has called to do it. Now God is the helper of that man. Is it not funny? You are helping a man that you have created to help you fulfill your purpose on the earth. It is wisdom on the part of God. So a man that is helped, another word for that is a man that is supported, a man that is sustained by God, will remain relevant, helping on the earth. He will be like a tree that is planted by the riverside that bring forth his fruit in season. If you want your wife to bring forth help for you in season, then you must help her. If she is giving help and no one supplies help to her, then she will be tired. She will be frustrated. This is a word that is enough for the wise. This is a word that will be good for us in ministry if we will not be exhausted. Now, when you quoted that, the second point, the second part, goodness, there was a scripture that came in my mind, so I was looking for it in Exodus. When God, it was a discussion between God and Moses. Moses wanted to see the face of God. And God said, you can't see my face and live. This is what will happen. He says, I will make all my goodness to pass before you. And then I will hide you under the cliff. I will do this, I will do that. Then later, that says, when my glory has passed, then I will. So it means there is an interchange of goodness and glory. So when God said it was not good for a man to be alone, it shows that there was no glory for a man that was alone. And check your life. If you are married, are you enjoying the glory you were enjoying when you were saying, is it the same thing with them? Is there no more honor for you? So there's goodness in marriage, but guess what? A woman that you have not helped to flourish, you have not supported, she cannot become a source of glory for you. In the point, if you cannot enjoy glory in your marriage, since you don't treat her with goodness, you are not a good man to her. Now, glory cannot come on you, because when people see her, people even reproach you because of her lifestyle. So, why you are expected to enjoy glory in marriage? A man could lack it by the way he relates with his wife. And the same thing for a woman. A woman has more glory in marriage than being single. But all these things is premised on being rightly married. A man who finds a wife has found a good thing and obtains favor. Everything that has been said is so important. Favor is obtained by a man when he finds a wife. So a man actually receives favor inside marriage. He is is not bringing favor, he's receiving it. But he wants to manage the will of God for his life. And until you receive that favor in your marriage, you can't say, you are favored, and you can't begin to express that favor. When we see you, we can't call you a favored man. This is a very strong word. It's like marriage 101, 102, it's like marriage 106. Each part is like 101, up to maybe each part is marriage 101, marriage 201, marriage 301, marriage like advanced. The last one looks sophisticated, fellowship. And she concluded with the unity of the faith. A house that is divided against itself cannot stand. So marriage is a place where a platform that God gives us to teach us unity. If you can be united, do you know the problem of the cause of division in the church? Is because even the marriages that form the church are divided marriages. A man and his wife who will never agree for a week are then made to become members of the church. They will cause disagreement in that church. Check the foundation of those who will never agree with anything. They don't also agree in their homes. So if a man can learn to tolerate other people's opinions in his marriage, then he can also tolerate people in the board meeting, in the committee meeting, in the service unit. So if a church is not right, the marriages are not right. If an organization is not right, the marriages that form it, they are not right. So fix the marriage, you fix the church, you fix the society. And this is how to fix it. Let's check these 6 parts. Let's check it. Let's make it like the 6 pillars of marriage. It's very important. I'm going to continue because there was a point she was talking about. I was even asking myself. I was not rating myself very high on that point. I said, Kai, I have a lot of work to do. Thank you for allowing God to use you to deliver such a word as this. Brother Francis, I want you to come and lead us in a prayer on this as the Holy Spirit leads you.